in this Good Friday reflection, we return to those events 2,000 years ago in Jerusalem. Can you go there in your minds and your imaginations to be like a witness of those incredible yet appalling events? For Jesus has arrived in Jerusalem one day to cheers and excitement about who he is and their expectations of what he's going to do. And yet, but a few days later, all he hears and experiences is derision, contempt. Those cheers have turned now to jeers, and he is abandoned by all, by his friends, by the authorities. He feels a sense of separation from his father, and there's no one, no one to stand up for him, to stand by him. And yet, despite all, he continues and follows this through, this journey of abandonment that will take him to the cross, where he will give himself, where he will surrender and give his life for the sake of us all, for the sake of this hurting and broken world. As we journey, may we realize and accept the depth of love that he shows for us, each one of us, no matter who we are or what we've done, by being there and giving himself completely and utterly on that cross. And so now let us continue as we hear step by step this story. They're together in the garden. It's dark. It's night. It's pitch black. Jesus has gone there to pray on this last night together with his friends. But his friends, they can't keep up with him. So whilst he's pouring out his heart, earnestly praying to his Father, aware of what lies ahead of him, and that sense of anguish that he's feeling, his friends have fallen asleep. You can imagine, perhaps, the sound of snoring, of deep sleep. Then he turns to them and says, "Where are you? Can't you even stay awake with me for a while?" And then all of a sudden the calm is broken, and then a crowd breaks through. Soldiers, followed by all kinds of people, carrying torches, lanterns and light, breaking into the darkness, lights flashing through the trees, and those beams of light looking and searching for one person in particular until they find him. And into the space they go, and they find Jesus. "Who do you want?" he says. "You," they say. Then Judas turns to the soldier and says, "This is the one. This is the one I've been telling you about, I've been preparing you for. I thought he was going to be the one. I thought he was going to be the one that would change everything." And Jesus says, "Yes, I am he." And so they grab Jesus and they take him away. He doesn't fight. He doesn't struggle. He just goes with them. It seems that Judas had a particular expectation. He's seen him at close quarters. Even though he has seen him at so closely over so many years, there's a sense in which he feels disappointed. He has very different expectations of what Jesus would do, like so many in the crowd. Is it this disappointment that's caused him to abandon his friend, not fully grasping that actually Jesus has come to do all that he expected and wanted, but even more, not just for one people feeling oppression in a particular place, but for all people in all times, struggling to feel free, free from the common thing that we all carry, that sense of self that so readily causes us to go our own way rather than God's way, and rather than finding life, finding instead struggle and death. Judas maybe did not understand that Jesus had to go this way, but Jesus did. Now the soldiers, they take Jesus to where the priests are gathering. And the high priest is there ready and waiting to probe Jesus with questions, to trap him, to find that way in which he can condemn Jesus and get rid of this person who they see as a troublemaker, someone who threatens their whole position. Outside, Peter waits. He's followed them. But as he's trying to keep warm, a servant girl comes up to him and says, "You're one of them, aren't you? You're one of his disciples. I'm sure I saw you with them." Peter looks at her, shakes his head and says, "No, not me. I think you've got the wrong person. Not me. I don't know him." Off she goes, shaking her head, still pretty sure that he's one of Jesus's friends. Somebody else comes up a short while later and says, "You're one of them as well, aren't you? I'm sure I've seen you with that group." And again, Peter looks at this man and says, "No, I don't know what you're talking about. Not me, mate." And again, this chap goes off and says, "I'm pretty sure I saw him." Another time later, maybe a little bit longer this time, somebody comes up to Peter and says, "You are one of them, aren't you? I've heard your accent. You're a Galilean. You're not from around here. You must have come with him. You can't deny that you know him. I'm pretty sure you know him." And at this point, Peter just kind of explodes and says, "No, not me. I don't know him at all. Give me a break." And at that very moment, a cock crows. And Peter hears that sound and he breaks down. He starts to sob because at that moment he remembers the words that Jesus spoke to him, that Jesus prophesied, that he would deny Jesus three times before the cock crowed. As he looked into that gathering where Jesus was with the priests, he could see Jesus turn to him and look straight at him. Peter couldn't bear that look, and off he went, utterly broken by that sense of betrayal. Despite all his promises that he would stand by Jesus, realizing that in the midst of the moment, he couldn't do it. How many of us can relate to Peter, the impetuous one who so readily said that he was going to stand by his friend Jesus, come what may, and yet when the pressure comes, he runs, he denies, he betrays his friend. He realizes that he's not what he thought he was. How easy for us it is to say we are going to follow Jesus, and then something comes along in life and deflects us, distracts us, and we realize without knowing it sometimes that we've gone our own way rather than God's way, rather than Jesus's way. And maybe we build up a sense of guilt and find it hard to return. We know that eventually Peter is restored, but at this moment, he is in despair at what he's done. I wonder how he interpreted Jesus's look across to him in those moments. Did he perceive it as a look of judgment and disappointment, but was it actually a look of love, of understanding of who Peter was, and that Jesus knew what he was doing and what he was going to do to enable people like Peter, in fact, for all of us who fail and wander, to know that we can always start anew, always start afresh, and be restored and forgiven. Imagine that look of love, looking at each one of us now. Now Jesus is taken from the high priests to Pilate. And Pilate is keen to meet Jesus. He's heard much about him. But it's now Passover. And Pilate asks the Jewish leaders what Jesus has done. Why is he here? What has he done? Well, he's a rebel, say the leaders. He says he's a king. He says he is God. But we're not allowed to put anyone to death. But you can. Hang on a minute, says Pilate. I need to ask him something myself. He looks at Jesus and says, what have you done wrong? Are you really the king of the Jews? And Jesus says, is that your own idea? My kingdom is not of this world, but from another place. So you are a king, says Pilate, but I find no basis on which to charge you. At that moment, Pilate wonders what to do. So he turns to the watching crowd and he says to them, do you want me to release this man, Jesus? And the crowd cries out and shouts, no, not him. Give us Jesus, Barabbas. We want Barabbas, Barabbas. And Pilate gives in to what they want. He says, here he is. I see no wrong in him. And he gives him over to the crowd who cry, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. We have no king but Caesar. The soldiers take him away. And Jesus is to experience some terrible moments at their hands. The crowd roars and cheers. Barabbas is set free, and Jesus is now truly on the path to his death. Now in this encounter with Pilate, and also beforehand with the priests, we see how power can hold power for its own sake. They're not concerned with justice. They're not concerned with the rights of an innocent. They are concerned purely with their position and power at all costs. And at these moments, it seems as though they have won. Because Barabbas is freed. The crowd gets what they think they want. And in the midst of that, there is Jesus now facing his death, but knowing so, and somehow knowing why too. In these moments, he travels a path into the worst things that human beings can do to another. And maybe in so travelling into those moments, he gives hope to those people who have experienced such awful suffering and injustice, as if to say that the Lord God is not distant and immune and uncaring about those kind of situations. And that in the end, his way, the way of grace, the way of a very different form of power, will overcome and will prevail. Now it was a long way to Golgotha, this place of execution outside the city walls. A particularly long walk for a man who'd been beaten savagely, endeavouring to carry a cross. He stumbled and fell numerous times. So the soldiers grabbed a man from the crowd, a man, Simon from Cyrene. And they say to him, "You here, come, carry this cross. Come on, just do it." And Simon carries that cross to the place where eventually it is fixed in place. And Jesus is nailed to the cross, nailed between two others. The soldiers sit around, drinking, gambling particularly over his clothes. They place a sign over his head saying, "The King of the Jews," although the priests don't like that. They want it to be said instead that he claimed to be the King of the Jews, but Pilate has insisted, no, it's the King of the Jews. People pass by and mock, shaking their heads and laughing. Who's going to save you now? If you're the Son of God, get yourself off that cross. Save yourself. And Jesus, there writhing in agony, cries out instead, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." And at that moment, he feels that sense of being alone, separated from everyone, although there's a small group where he looks out and can see his mother with some friends and his good friend John as well. There is that sound of weeping. It was noon, and darkness has been steadily creeping over the land. And then there is long darkness for 3 hours as he struggles on the cross. And then he gives out a loud cry. My God, why have you forsaken me?" Then abandoned to his fate by everyone, he gives his last cry and shouts out and cries out, "It is finished." And in that moment, he dies. And the temple curtain elsewhere is torn in two. And there's a whole shaking of the land around there. A whole shaking of the people too. Jesus now is dead. There is a darkness at the heart of this story, which can be so difficult to face into and be with. We need to allow ourselves to be in that place for a time, to be in that dark place. Not to avoid it, but to recognise the reality that still lies at the heart of the human experience. And to realise that Jesus, out of love, was willing to go into that darkest of experiences, that darkest of places. When we look at some of what's going on in the world at large today, we realise the reality of that, whether we like it or not. And yet, there were those who saw and realised that there was something happening in what Jesus was doing. There were the two thieves on the cross, one who mocked and the other who said to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." There was a soldier who looked on, saw what happened, and said the words, "Surely this was the Son of God." And those words were to go on to be recorded in the gospel so that many others might hear and understand and come to faith in the Lord Jesus. Truly, he was the Son of God, said that man. Who do we say he is for us? What will our response be to this amazing love? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you loved us so much, that you were willing to walk that path that took you to the cross, to die, so that we might be forgiven, so we might know the depth of your love, and so that we might rise with you and be with you and share in your life forever and be a part of your work here on earth, in seeing your kingdom come bit by bit whilst we await your return. Come, Lord Jesus, and fill us afresh with your light and your love. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. His wounds have paid my ransom.